Pantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents Pup Fiction by Laurien Berenson. Narrated by Angie Hickman. Chapter 1. On a list of things that bring joy to a mother's heart, the first day of school must surely rank near the top. And the first day of summer camp cannot be far behind. Just the thought of all those melted popsicles, wet bathing suits, skin knees, and sticky fingers occurring somewhere other than my house was enough to bring a smile to my face. My two sons, riding in the car with me, weren't similarly amused. "What?" Davy glanced my way. He was sitting beside me on the front seat. Soon to turn 15, Davy had just finished his freshman year of high school. By his estimation, that meant he was the smartest person in the car. He'd grown 2 inches over the winter and had recently buzz-cut his hair in preparation for starting his first real job. For the next 4 weeks, he would be a junior counselor at Graceland Nursery School summer camp. "It's nothing," I said quickly. "No, it's not." He looked suspicious. "You're smiling."
"Is that a bad thing?"
"I'm smiling too," Kevin crowed from the back seat. My younger son was 5 and an optimist by nature. A blonde-haired, blue-eyed bundle of energy, he was looking forward to spending the next month swimming, hiking, and making new friends. Kev had been to preschool. Indeed, he'd graduated from Graceland in the spring, but camp would be a new adventure. Now he had one arm looped around the neck of the big black standard poodle sitting next to him. The poodle was Faith, my constant companion for the previous 9 years. A glance in the rearview mirror confirmed that she had drawn close to Kevin on purpose. Poodles are an empathetic breed. She'd sensed that for all my son's bravado, he was a bit nervous about his first day. "I'm smiling because I'm happy," I said to Davy. "You should be too. Having a job is something to be excited about."
"I'm excited about the prospect of a paycheck," he said with a grin.
I slanted him a look. That wasn't what I'd meant, and he knew it.
"Okay, yeah. Maybe I'm looking forward to trying out my cat herding skills."
"Cats?" Kev piped up, surprised. "There are going to be cats?"
"Not real cats," I told him. "Davy means you and all the other campers in the younger groups. He's saying it's hard to keep an eye on a dozen 5-year-olds at once."
"We're not cats," Kevin grumbled.
Davy twisted around in his seat.
"It's just an expression, Munchkin. You're not supposed to take it literally."
"And I'm not a munchkin."
Kev crossed his arms over his chest.
"Nicknames are for babies."
"No, they're not," I said. "Nicknames are for people you love."
"Ew,"
said Davy. Kev laughed and joined in.
"Ew."
Faith wagged her tail happily. I could hear it thumping up and down against the seat. She didn't know what the boys were complaining about, but she liked the sound of their protest. Graceland Nursery School was situated on 5 acres of rolling land in the northeast corner of Stamford, Connecticut. Founded 18 years earlier by teacher Emily Grace, the small preschool was noted for its friendly atmosphere and its adherence to the principle that early learning should be fun. Kevin and Davy had both attended the school, and Davy had also been a camper when he was young. I pulled through the gate, and we followed the driveway until we came to 2 weathered, clapboard buildings. They were angled apart from each other and connected by a low, covered walkway. The main building in front of us housed the classrooms, plus a gym and a locker room. The smaller building off to our left held several administrative offices, a storeroom, and the school cafeteria. Emily lived in an apartment upstairs. Behind those structures was a spacious lawn with a playground and a soccer field. An enclosed swimming pool sat off to one side. On the other side, an incline sloped downward toward a picturesque pond where campers sailed toy boats and attempted, usually unsuccessfully, to catch frogs. The school property ended in a thick belt of woods that merged its rear boundary with that of its neighbors. The compact parking lot near the admin building was flanked by a row of leafy maple trees. I bypassed the drop-off area in front of the main structure and pulled the Volvo into a shaded parking space. As the boys got out of the car, I opened all the windows.
Faith would have to wait here for a few minutes while I got Davy and Kevin situated. Since it was opening day, new counselors had been told to check in 30 minutes before campers were due to arrive. For now, the yard in front of the school was still mostly empty. I knew from past experience, however, that it would soon look like bedlam, with hordes of children trying to figure out where they were supposed to go. At the moment, there were only a few people in sight. A group of teenagers, all neatly dressed in khaki shorts and white polo shirts, were gathered near the entrance to the other building. Davy's fellow counselors, I presumed. A young woman with a rounded figure and an eager smile stood ready to assist us at the end of the sidewalk that connected the driveway to the school. I immediately recognized Amy's cheerful assistant, Mia. She had a clipboard in her hands and a pen tucked behind one ear. The bun on top of her head was starting to come loose, tendrils frizzing into curls in the summer heat. Mia had a name tag affixed to the front of her shirt, with her name written in large red letters. She'd used a purple marker to add a smiley face next to it.
"Hello, Miss Travis. Hi, Kevin," she called in a bubbly voice as we approached. "Welcome to the July session of Graceland Summer Camp."
"Thanks," I said. "We're delighted to be here." Mia turned to my older son.
"You must be Davy. We're happy to have you as a new addition to the staff, and it's nice to finally meet you. Kevin talks about you all the time."
"He does?" Davy sounded surprised, and maybe a little pleased. Mia nodded.
"I do,"
Kevin confirmed, sounding quite pleased with himself. Mia looked down at her clipboard.
"Davy, you'll be working with Courtney. The two of you will be in charge of our jellyfish group."
She pointed toward the group of teens.
"Go introduce yourself to your fellow counselors. See the guy with the red hair? That's Brian. He's in charge. He'll tell you everything you need to know."
"Terrific." Davy turned and strode away, leaving us without even saying goodbye. I stared after him. I probably had a disgruntled look on my face because Mia giggled.
"Teenagers," she said with a shrug. "What can you do?"
Mia was less than a decade beyond her teenage years herself, but she had a point. If Davy'd had his way, I'd have dropped him and Kev off at the end of the driveway so he wouldn't have to be seen arriving at camp with his mother.
"I'm going to be a sunfish," Kevin announced. "Yes, you are," Mia agreed. "Your counselors are Kayla and Luke, and several of your former classmates will be in the group with you."
She looked up at me.
"Why don't you take Kevin inside and get his things stashed in his locker? A few other kids have already arrived. They're hanging out in the music room with one of the older counselors. You can leave Kevin there."
"Thanks, I'll do that," I said. "Is Emily here this morning? If she is, I'd like to say hello." Actually, I'd been surprised not to find Emily out here ready to greet the new arrivals. After all, Graceland was her school.
"Of course."
Mia's head bobbed a quick nod.
"She's in her office now, but I expect her out here shortly. I'm sure she'll be happy to see you."
Kevin and I entered the main building. We found his locker and placed his backpack and lunch inside. Then I walked him to the music room, where a teenage girl was leading half a dozen campers in a sing-along. Without missing a beat, she beckoned Kevin into the room and dismissed me with a cheery wave. Now that he was on familiar ground, Kevin's earlier trepidation had vanished. He went skipping in happily to join the others. In less than 10 minutes, I'd gotten both boys to their assigned places. That had to be some kind of record. I hurried back outside to retrieve Faith from the car. The big poodle was waiting for me with her head poked out the open window. When I opened the door, she hopped out of the Volvo with her tail wagging. Faith had no idea what we'd be doing next, but it didn't matter. She was just happy to be part of the plan. All dogs are wonderful, but poodles are particularly perfect. I live with 5 of them, however, so I may be somewhat biased about that. Faith had entered my life when she was a young puppy, arriving as a gift from her breeder, my Aunt Peg. I'd quickly discovered that poodles are smart, easy to live with, and always entertaining. They're companion dogs who will gladly adapt to just about any lifestyle as long as they can be with their people. Poodles also love a good joke, especially one at their owner's expense. Faith is a standard, the tallest of the 3 poodle varieties. Her head comes to just above my waist, so she's within easy reach for either a pat or a conversation, both of which happen often. She has dark, intelligent eyes and a short blanket of dense black curls covering her body. Faith is both a clown and a sage. She's also my best friend. I hope she lives forever, because I can't bear to think about the alternative. My ankle twinged as Faith and I strode across the parking lot to the smaller building. I'd broken my fibula in February. Although the break had healed well, it still ached sometimes when I walked on hard ground. The accident that had caused the break had been my own fault, so I tried to think of the pain as a useful reminder to watch my step. When I slowed down, Faith ran on ahead. Nose to the ground, she checked out all the unfamiliar scents while also keeping an eye out for errant squirrels. She circled back as I reached the building, and we entered it together. Emily's office was halfway down the hall. She must have heard us coming because before we reached the doorway, she was already stepping out of the room to meet us. I'd known Emily Grace for more than a decade. In all that time, she hadn't changed much. Now in her mid-40s, she had a slender, well-toned frame and long blonde hair that swung loose around her shoulders. The crow's feet etched at the corner of her eyes were new, but she remained as lovely as ever. Emily loved her job, and she was very good at it. Maybe that was why she almost always seemed to be smiling. She wasn't doing so now, however. Even as we exchanged a quick hug, she still looked preoccupied. "What's the matter?" I asked when we'd drawn apart. "Nothing," Emily replied quickly. Perhaps too quickly. Then she shrugged. "Oh, you know, first day jitters." She reached down and scratched beneath Faith's chin. "Hello, pretty girl. It's nice to see you again." "Don't think you can change the subject by talking to my dog," I said.
"You're kidding, right?"
Emily almost laughed.
"You talk to that poodle more than most people talk to their spouses."
There was that.
"Come on in and sit down."
She waved me to a comfy seat, then pulled out the chair behind her desk.
"I have a few minutes before I need to be out front. Let's catch up."
"You probably don't have to hurry," I told her. "Mia seems to have everything under control."
"I'm sure she does. Mia is a whiz at getting things done."
Emily frowned slightly.
"That girl loves to make herself useful. She solves problems before I'm even aware that they exist. In the 6 months she's been here, she's managed to make herself all but indispensable."
"That's a good thing," I said. "Right?"
"Yes, of course, I guess. Although, to tell the truth, sometimes her constant activity drives me a little batty."
There was a threadbare rug on the office floor. Emily paused to watch Faith turn two circles before lying down.
"Or maybe it's just that Mia makes me feel old. I remember when I had that much energy, and it seems like a long time ago."
"I don't believe that for a minute," I said, "any more than I think you have first day jitters. You're an old hand at this. It's what, your 15th year of running the camp?"
"Something like that. But it feels like every year is a new challenge, or maybe just a new chance for something to go wrong."
I stared at her across the room. That wasn't at all what I'd expected to hear. "Is there something in particular that you're concerned about?"
Emily finally managed a small smile. "Because being entrusted with the care and custody of nearly 54 to 7-year-olds isn't enough of a worry?"
"Okay, I get that," I smiled with her. "In your place, I'd probably be a basket case. But you're terrific at what you do."
"So are you. Don't think I've forgotten that summer all those years ago when you got roped into filling in when I needed a substitute counselor. You did a great job. The kids all loved you."
I couldn't help but notice that Emily had deftly changed the subject. Perhaps my probing had touched a nerve.
"Now Kevin's a camper," she continued, "and Davy, who was a sunfish back then, is a counselor himself. That must feel like deja vu to you."
"More like things have come full circle, I think." Looking back, it seemed as though the previous 10 years had gone by in a flash. I was about to mention that when there was a tremendous crash in the room above us. I winced and ducked to one side. It sounded as though the ceiling had cracked. Faith was just as startled as I was. She leapt to her feet and began to bark. I went to grab her. I wanted to calm her down, but the poodle eluded my grasp. She'd never done that before. When Faith became upset, I paid attention. Now that made two of us wondering what the heck was going on. Chapter 2. Faith wasn't the only one on her feet. Emily had jumped up too. "Those damn dogs," she said. "Dogs? What dogs?" Then abruptly I remembered. In the spring, Graceland School had become home to 3 rambunctious Dalmatian puppies. Occasionally I catch a glimpse of them when I was dropping Kev off or picking him up. The spotted trio had been roly-poly youngsters when they'd appeared in April. Now they must be around 6 months old. Not a good age to have been left alone without supervision. That thought brought me to my feet as well. "Where are your puppies?" I asked. Emily pointed toward the ceiling, which remarkably was not in tatters on the floor around us. "Guess." "That's your apartment, right?" I'd never seen it, but I knew it was there. "You live upstairs?" "I do if the place is still in one piece. Right now, I'm thinking the chances of that are about 50-50. I wouldn't have taken those odds myself. Apparently, the puppies were loose up there by themselves, and it sounded as though they were having a great time. "You didn't want to crate them?" I asked. She shrugged. "I might have if I owned crates." Yes, that definitely would have been helpful. I started to say something else, then stopped. My relationship with Emily had always been cordial, but she and I really only knew each other in a professional capacity, either as teacher and parent or briefly as employer and employee. I hoped my curiosity about the Dalmatians wasn't causing me to overstep some unspoken boundary. "I usually try to keep the puppies with me," Emily said. She sounded apologetic. "Or at least somewhere nearby. But this is the first day of camp, and you know what that's like. Today, I just wanted them out of the way, in a place where they couldn't cause any trouble." If that had been her goal, it appeared she'd failed miserably. Another thump, this one not nearly as large as the first, came from above us. Emily and I both gazed upward with trepidation. Yep, there was definitely a crack in the ceiling. At least Faith was no longer barking. She'd returned to stand with her body pressed against my leg. Clearly, she was feeling apologetic, too. I reached down and gave the poodle a pat. Her earlier transgression was forgotten. She and I were good. Emily sighed. She briefly closed her eyes. She was probably imagining the damage being done upstairs. I figured I probably shouldn't mention that. When my family's male dogs were in the mood to make some serious mischief, they'd been known to attack our couch cushions. "Don't you have a pen for the puppies out back?" I asked. I was pretty sure I'd once seen the Dalmatians confined behind the school. "Yes." "Why didn't you put them in there?" "That's just it. I did." I frowned.
"You did what?"
"I got up this morning and took them for a long run to wear them out. Then I put them in their pen. Early. It was before 7 o'clock. I knew today was going to be hectic. I figured it was the safest place for them to be."
"But they're not out there now," I pointed out.
"I know that," Emily snapped. "Something went wrong. I have no idea what. Next thing I knew, Mia was calling to tell me that the puppies were loose and playing in traffic out on the road. She'd seen them when she was driving in. She said they nearly caused an accident."
Yikes.
No wonder Emily was upset. That was every dog owner's worst nightmare. "I ran out to get them, but they wouldn't listen to me. Those little stinkers thought we were playing a game. It took me 20 minutes to round them up. By that time, I was covered in dirt and sweating like a pig. In the end, I had to bribe them with hot dogs." Entertaining as that visual was, I didn't dare laugh. Apparently, Emily had yet to train her puppies to pay attention to her. If only she'd required the same respect from them that she did from her students, that whole misadventure would have played out differently. "At that point, I didn't dare put them back in the pen," Emily continued, "because I didn't know how they got out the first time. So I was afraid they'd just escape again."
"Good thinking," I agreed.
I was running out of time, so I brought them up to the apartment with me. The puppies were worn out by then. They fell asleep while I was making myself presentable again.
Emily's expression turned glum.
Now it sounds as though they've gotten their second wind.
You think?
But I can't do anything about that now because they need to stay locked up until after morning drop-off. So remember earlier, when you asked me what was the matter?
Yes, I said. And now I get it. Emily sagged back against the edge of her desk. Suspicious noises were still coming from the room above us.
Why don't these things ever happen on a quiet weekend morning?
Because that would make life entirely too easy, I replied. Tell me what I can do to help.
Unexpectedly, Emily grinned. Last time you asked me that question, you ended up working here for the summer.
Good point.
Not this time, I said, but I was smiling too.
Why don't we go and have a look at your pen? Maybe the puppies dug their way out, or maybe there's something wrong with the latch.
Emily walked over to the window. It overlooked the parking lot and the school entrance. Cars were beginning to form a line down the driveway, but drop-off was proceeding in an orderly fashion. Mia and the head counselor, Brian, appeared to have everything under control.
I guess we can spare 10 minutes, she decided. I still feel frazzled from all that running around. This'll give me a chance to catch my breath. Me standing out front and looking like a crazy lady is not the first thing parents should see when they arrive to entrust their kids to our care.
Emily and I headed for the door. Faith fell in beside us. That jittery feeling is adrenaline, I told her. It should fade soon. Those puppies must have given you quite a scare. She nodded.
All I could think was, what if one of them got hit by a car? Or even worse, caused someone to crash? It could have been a disaster.
A door at the far end of the hallway took us out the back of the building. We walked past the playground, with its swing sets, slides, and elaborate climbing equipment. Beyond it was the puppy's pen. 6 feet wide and 10 feet long, the enclosure was constructed of tall chain-link fencing. It looked solid and well-built. There were no gaps between the fence and the ground, nor had the puppies dug any holes that I could see. But the door to the pen was standing half open. Emily frowned as we approached.
I'm sure I closed that gate this morning.
Faith trotted on ahead of us and began to sniff along the outer edge of the pen's wire fence. She'd never met Emily's Dalmatians, but she was already forming an opinion about them.
Today you were probably more distracted than usual, I pointed out. And maybe you were in a hurry?
I suppose it's possible that I wasn't careful enough.
She sounded annoyed with herself.
It's opening day and I had a million little details to think about. But could I really be such a scatterbrain that I didn't remember to latch the gate?
Let's find out. I examined the metal locking mechanism. It was simple enough. Just a horseshoe-shaped bar that slipped up so the gate could be opened and then down again to hold it closed. I locked the gate and rattled it hard. It made some noise, but held firm.
It's pretty sturdy, I told her. I can't imagine that the puppies were able to open it themselves. That's the good news.
Emily shot me a sideways look.
And the bad news is that I'm an idiot, right?
I wasn't going to put it exactly that way.
I'm always telling the kids that honesty is the best policy, she sighed. I guess I should practice what I preach.
I rattled the gate again.
More good news. Now that you know the pen is secure, you can bring the puppies back out here rather than letting them continue to tear up your apartment.
That's the best idea I've heard all day, she said.
We turned to head back to the school buildings. Her inspection of the pen complete, Faith came skipping along behind us. I know the puppies have been here since spring, I said, but where did they come from?
It's a long story.
Emily didn't sound happy about that.
Short version, they were a gift.
3 at once?
I looked at her in surprise.
I'm not sure if that's a gift or a burden.
Believe me, that was my first thought too. But they've turned out to be a big hit with the children. You know, because of the movie? Everybody's seen it.
So the kids are excited to get to meet 3 live Dalmatians, and the puppies have been wonderful with them. Posey likes to lick noses.
Cute name.
Thanks. The other 2 are Poppy and Pansy. The nursery school was in session when they arrived, so I let the kids name them.
It sounds as though they're all bitches.
Bitches? Emily repeated. She looked shocked. No insult intended, I told her. That's the correct term for a female dog.
It is? Really? Now I am insulted. Who do you suppose came up with that?
I have no idea.
Actually, I'd never wondered about it before.
What's the term for a male dog?
Dog, I grinned.
Seriously?
I kid you not.
Emily shook her head. There's something wrong with that system.
I couldn't argue with that.
My family lived in North Stamford, too, so when Faith and I left Graceland Camp, we were home in just 10 minutes. Home was a colonial house in a quiet residential neighborhood. 2-acre zoning meant that none of our neighbors were close enough to be bothered by the fact that we had 6 dogs who often ran around outside in our enclosed yard. 6 dogs hadn't been the plan in the beginning, but somehow they just kept accumulating. 5 members of our canine crew were black Standard Poodles, all retired show dogs. Eve was Faith's daughter. My second husband, Sam, had brought 2 poodles of his own to the marriage, an older bitch named Raven and Tar, a gorgeous young male. Augie came along when Davy was old enough to have a dog of his own. Then there was Bud. He was a small, spotted dog of indeterminate lineage, whom Davy and I had found one day by the side of the road. Initially, we'd intended to get him healthy and find him a home, but Bud had other ideas. He'd immediately attached himself to Kevin, and that was that. Before I even turned in the driveway, I saw the maroon minivan parked beside the garage. Faith knew what that meant. She stood up on the seat and pressed her nose against the window. Her tail began to whip back and forth.
Aunt Peg is here.
Yes, I know, I said with a sigh.
This will be fun.
Of course, Faith would think so. Aunt Peg loved all dogs without reservation. People were another matter. She and I had a complicated relationship, made all the more difficult by the fact that she refused to acknowledge any of the many ways she continued to drive me crazy. When Aunt Peg showed up unexpectedly, it usually meant she wanted something. And her requests seldom turned out to be simple. Or easy. Which was probably why she brought them to me. Because I'd never successfully figured out how to say no to her. Aunt Peg was in her 70s, but the passage of time hadn't affected either her energy level or her mental acuity. She was 6 feet tall and built like a brick wall. Her store of knowledge was vast, and she was insatiably curious about the things she didn't know. Aunt Peg asked too many questions, believed strongly in her own opinions, and couldn't abide foolish people. Some days it was a challenge just holding a conversation with her. A longtime breeder of superb Standard Poodles, Aunt Peg was now a respected dog show judge. She was approved for the toy and non-sporting groups, and lately she'd been eyeing several of the herding breeds to add to her roster. I pulled the Volvo up beside Aunt Peg's van. Faith quickly jumped out and ran to the gate that led to the backyard. Sam and Aunt Peg must have been outside on the deck. I briefly contemplated sneaking into the house through the garage. It was only wishful thinking, but I took a moment to enjoy the idea anyway. Having heard our arrival, the other poodles began to gather near the fence. Then Bud came running over. He and Faith touched noses through the gate. The spotted dog began to pop up and down like a jack-in-the-box. He punctuated each leap with a shrill yip. Bud might have been a small dog, but he had a big bark. Sure, I thought. Tell the whole neighborhood I'm home. Now I had no choice but to go find out what Aunt Peg wanted this time. Chapter 3. When I reached the gate, Sam was already standing on the other side. He shooed the dogs away so he could open it long enough for me to slip through. Big black poodles eddied around both our legs as I looked up to thank him with a quick smile. Sam was 6 inches taller than me, and he filled out a t-shirt and shorts handsomely. His shaggy blonde hair was swept back off his forehead.
Blue eyes, much like Kevin's, gazed down at me.
Did everything go okay at camp? He asked. I thought you'd be back half an hour ago.
It was fine, I said as I reached down to greet each dog individually. Tar pushed his way to the front of the group and nearly knocked me over. Eve hung back and waited for me to come to her. There was just one minor complication.
Oh?
Aunt Peg was on the deck, reclining on a lounge chair with a cup of Earl Grey tea within easy reach. She loved complications. I'd known that would pique her interest.
What happened?
Here's a better question, I replied. What are you doing here? Aunt Peg straightened in her seat.
Is that any way to greet your favorite relative?
Favorite? Aunt Peg was giving herself entirely too much credit. I was pretty sure she wasn't even in the top five. And that was before I started adding the poodles to the list.
I think I'll go inside and refill my coffee, Sam said to no one in particular.
Please bring me a cup too, I asked. Whatever Aunt Peg was up to now, it was sure to go down better accompanied by a strong jolt of caffeine.
Of course.
Sam disappeared with alacrity. Bud followed him inside. The little dog had been skinny when we brought him home. His weight was fine now, but Bud still never missed a chance to visit the kitchen. He seemed to believe food would magically fall into his mouth when he was there. And sometimes, especially when Kevin was around, it did.
So?
Aunt Peg prompted.
You were in the middle of a story.
I was?
Indeed. It was about complications.
Oh, I grinned. I only said that to get your attention.
Well, it worked. I'm all ears. Tell me the rest.
It was about Dalmatian puppies.
I see.
Now she looked skeptical.
Were there more than 100 of them? And a woman with a white streak in her hair?
No, just 3. I sat down in a rattan chair with a thick cushion on its seat. And the woman is a blonde.
That sounds like Emily Grace.
Sam reappeared with a mug of coffee in each hand. He'd added a splash of milk to mine, just the way I liked it. He settled into a matching chair beside me. I noted that Bud had remained behind in the kitchen. He was probably busy nosing around the pantry. The poodles, meanwhile, had run off to play a game of tag around the trees in the yard.
Who's Emily Grace?
Aunt Peg wanted to know.
And why does she have 2 first names?
She's the proprietor of Graceland Nursery School. I took a welcome sip of coffee. And Grace is her last name.
And she has 3 Dalmatian puppies?
Aunt Peg asked.
All at once? Is she a breeder?
Of course, that was the conclusion she would leap to. Most of Aunt Peg's best friends bred purebred dogs. No, nothing like that, I said. The puppies were a gift.
From whom?
She didn't say.
Aha,
Aunt Peg smiled.
A woman of mystery. Despite her name, I like her already.
You would like Emily. She's smart and capable. She runs her own business and mostly makes it look easy. You would call her a useful person. Aunt Peg should have been pleased by that. Useful people were her favorite sort. Instead, she snorted under her breath. She was probably reserving judgment until she could meet Emily and decide for herself. The puppies' names are Poppy, Posy, and Pansy, I said. The children named them.
We can tell, Sam grinned.
3 bitches, then,
Aunt Peg said.
How old are they?
They were youngsters back in April, I told her. It was just after the 4th of July now. So around 6 months, I would guess.
Has Emily made plans to get them spayed?
I don't know. I didn't ask.
Well, you should. Reproductive responsibility is important, especially when dealing with puppies that apparently showed up out of nowhere.
The puppies didn't come from nowhere, I told her. They were a gift.
So you said, but I'm not sure I believe it. Who would give someone 3 Dalmatian puppies all at once? All the same age, so probably from the same litter. It seems much more likely that they escaped from somebody's backyard and your Emily Grace took them in.
As it happens, I admitted,
They do seem to be accomplished escape artists. They got out of their pen this morning and ran out to the road in front of the school.
The plot thickens, Aunt Peg muttered.
Actually, that's pretty much where the plot ends.
I hope no one was hurt, said Sam.
Thankfully, no. By the time we arrived, Emily had recaptured the puppies and locked them away. Aunt Peg was not appeased. Judging by the frown on her face, she was thinking about the lecture she wanted to deliver to Emily. I took another sip of coffee and repeated my earlier question. Aunt Peg, why are you here?
Apparently, I came to listen to a story about Dalmatian puppies, she retorted, and not a very good one at that.
As if I would believe that. Aunt Peg had never even heard of the puppies until 5 minutes ago. The woman was the queen of ulterior motives. I knew she had to be up to something. The poodle pack came circling back to us. Tar and Augie were exhilarated by their run. The two males looked ready to take another lap around the big yard. Faith, Eve, and Raven joined us on the deck to lie down in the shade. I put my mug down on the side table and went inside to fill a bowl with cold water for the dogs. I expected to find Bud in the pantry. Instead, he was in the kitchen, sitting in front of the refrigerator and staring at the closed door, hopefully. Faith knew how to open the appliance, but thankfully she hadn't taught that trick to Bud. There's nothing there for you, I said as I picked up the water bowl from the floor and rinsed it out. Bud hopped to his feet. His stubby tail wagged so energetically that his hindquarters were wiggling from side to side. That little dog was cute, and he knew it. I can't feed you, I told him when I turned off the tap. Otherwise, I'd have to give the poodle something, too. They're outside. Bud shimmied some more. A black spotted ear flopped up and down over one eye. I won't tell. Oh, for Pete's sake. I set the full bowl of water down on the counter, then crossed the kitchen in three quick steps. There was an open bag of kibble in the pantry, now stored high enough that Bud couldn't reach it. I put my hand inside and pulled out two small pieces. Bud was right behind me. His mouth was open and ready. His pink tongue slipped out and flicked the kibble out of my fingers. Bud didn't even bother to chew before swallowing. Happy now? I asked. He jumped up to dance on his hind legs. Again, again. I didn't even dignify that with a reply. Instead, I went to get the water dish, then made sure that Bud came too when I went back outside. I set the big bowl down on the deck, and Raven and Eve drank noisily. Tar and Augie had run off again. Faith was lying underneath my chair. What did I miss? I asked Sam.
We were talking about the dog show on Saturday, he said. Peg thinks Coral will have a good shot at taking the major in standard bitches.
Of course she thought that. The woman never lacked for confidence. Plus, she was Coral's breeder, so in the way of good dog breeders everywhere, she was predisposed to admire her own bitch. Which was not to say that Coral didn't have many admirable qualities. She was a lovely standard poodle, the product of numerous generations of Aunt Peg's superior breeding. Had Aunt Peg been planning to show Coral herself, the win probably would have been a lock. Instead, 14-year-old Davy would be in the show ring at the end of Coral's leash. That partnership had been formed the previous summer when the poodle was just beginning her show career. Aunt Peg, Coral's owner, was busy with her own judging duties. Also, she was loath to appear in other judges' rings and perhaps incite talk of impropriety. After Davy had shown Augie to his championship, he'd been eager to continue honing his handling skills. When Aunt Peg asked for his help, he quickly agreed. In theory, the alliance should have benefited both of them. In reality, the pair often found themselves arguing over who was in charge. Coral had won 5 of the 15 points needed to become a champion by the time she was a year old. At that point, she'd taken time off from the show ring to grow into her new adult trim. The young bitch now looked very elegant in her continental clip, with a large coat of mane hair covering the front half of her body, rounded bracelets and rosettes on her lower legs and hips, and a glorious pompon on the end of her tail. Since February, she and Davy had amassed an additional 5 points. That meant Coral was now in need of 2 major wins to finish her championship. In dog show competition, points were awarded to the winner's dog and winner's bitch, based on the number of same-sex dogs beaten on the day. The number can be as low as a single point or as high as 5. included in the total of 15, a dog must also win 2 majors, meaning he must defeat enough competition for the win to be worth 3 or more points. Major wins are hard to come by and highly prized. At times, that level of competition can also be difficult to find. Coral was now in the unenviable position known in the dog show world as stuck for majors. So this upcoming dog show, with its healthy entry and standard poodle bitches, mattered a lot to all of us. I narrowed my eyes and stared at Aunt Peg. She'd brought Eve up onto the lounge chair beside her, and her fingers were tangling idly through the poodle's top knot. "Davy's looking forward to the show," I said. "He's ready."
"I'm sure he thinks he is," she replied, "but one can never be too prepared."
"What does that mean exactly?" Sam asked. In the past, we'd both been frustrated by Aunt Peg's attempt to micromanage everything about Davy's performance.
"I was just thinking that a little tune-up of his skills wouldn't be a bad thing,"
she smiled complacently.
"I'd be happy to step in and give him a handling lesson."
No way, I thought. Aunt Peg's constructive criticism had about as much finesse as King Kong had used to swat down pesky airplanes. "I'm sure that won't be necessary," I said.
"Let's not forget there's a major on the line."
There seemed to be very little chance that any of us would forget that, which was why ratcheting up the pressure on Davy to put in a stellar performance was precisely the wrong way to go about things. "If it will make you feel better, I can work with him this week," said Sam. Aunt Peg frowned, then nodded.
"I suppose that will have to do."
She nudged Eve gently to one side and stood up.
"I'll be going then. Thank you for the tea and the lovely company."
It was unlike Aunt Peg to give in so easily, I thought. Could that truly be all she'd wanted? I glanced over at Sam. He just shrugged. He was baffled too. "We could have had this conversation over the phone," I pointed out.
"What would be the fun in that?"
Aunt Peg asked.
"Besides, I thought you two might be lonely, with both boys out of the house now. There's a name for that, isn't there? Empty nest syndrome?"
She had to know that referred to teenagers leaving for college and adulthood, not nursery school summer camp. But whatever. Sam and I followed Aunt Peg to the gate. Hand resting on the latch, she paused as if something had just occurred to her.
"Oh, there was one other thing I wanted to mention."
And here it came, finally.
"What will you be doing a month from now, say around the second week of August?"
Sam and I shared a look. It was summer vacation. Who bothered to plan that far ahead? Certainly not us. I said.
"Good answer,"
Aunt Peg replied.
"I was hoping I could count on you to do me a small favor."
"Sure," Sam replied. I kicked him in the ankle. Hadn't his long association with my family, and particularly with Aunt Peg, taught him anything? Never make a promise until you find out what you're getting into.
"You know Willow,"
Aunt Peg said. Sam and I both nodded. Willow was one of Aunt Peg's standard poodles. A beautiful bitch. She was also Coral's dam.
"She's pregnant."
"What?" I yelped. That was a surprise. "Since when?" Sam didn't need to ask. He was already counting backward.
"Early June,"
Aunt Peg informed us blithely.
"I wasn't sure the breeding would take, but it did. Since there's nothing on your schedule, I was thinking you two might like to whelp a litter of puppies for me."
Chapter 4. "Holy moly," I said. "How did that happen?"
"Quite on purpose, I assure you,"
Aunt Peg replied.
"A great deal of planning and forethought went into this mating."
"But why didn't you tell us?"
"I'm telling you now. I didn't mention it to anyone beforehand. It's madness for someone with my schedule to even consider having a litter of puppies. But what choice did I have? Willow isn't getting any younger. This will be her last litter.
Puppies, said Sam. He had a goofy grin on his face. I probably did too. Who didn't love a litter of puppies?
There was just one thing I couldn't control,
Aunt Peg said. We all knew what that was.
Of course, Willow came in season at an inconvenient time,
she continued,
but I didn't dare let her go by again. So I went ahead and did the breeding, even though I'd already committed to an out-of-state judging assignment the week the litter will be due.
Who did you breed her to? Sam asked. He and Aunt Peg could spend hours discussing standard poodle families and pedigrees and all the possible ways to combine them. Aunt Peg named a West Coast dog whose progeny she had judged and admired. The dog's owner was an old friend of hers, and their bloodlines had mingled throughout the years with excellent results. Good choice, I said. Aunt Peg nodded. If the mating hadn't been a good choice, or more accurately, an excellent choice, she wouldn't have done it. Somehow, I couldn't stop smiling. I'd known Aunt Peg was up to something, but I'd never expected this. Caring for a litter of puppies was a big commitment, even when they weren't your own. Maybe especially then. Puppies needed plenty of quality care and attention. They took over your house and your lives. Maybe Sam and I should discuss this before agreeing. Oh, who was I kidding? I thought. Puppies were more fun than anything else in the world. We'll do it, I said. Aunt Peg unlatched the gate and let herself out.
Of course you will. I never doubted it for a minute.
She takes us for granted, I said to Sam as we watched Aunt Peg drive away.
Yes, but this time I don't mind.
Sam's smile was back.
We're going to have a litter of puppies.
No, Aunt Peg is going to have puppies, I corrected him. We're just the surrogate parents.
Close enough. Wait until the boys find out.
Yikes. I hadn't even thought about that. We turned back toward the house. And here I thought we were going to have a nice, quiet summer, I said. Sam looked skeptical.
Did you ever actually believe that?
I was trying to.
Good luck with that, he said.
Predictably, when they heard the news, Davy and Kevin were even more excited about it than Sam and I were. Kevin and Bud danced around the living room together. Kev's sneakers squeaked on the hardwood floor. His t-shirt, rumpled and stained from camp, twisted around his narrow waist as he and Bud spun circles around each other.
A new puppy for me, he cried. I'm going to name him Fluffy.
Not so fast, I said. Kev stopped dancing. So did Bud. The two of them stared at me with wide eyes. I hated always having to be the bad guy. You were the one with the goofy grin, I said to Sam. You explain it to him. Sam nodded. Then instead, he changed the subject. He hunkered down to Kev's level.
How was your first day of camp?
Kev's face lit up. Suddenly, he was happy again.
It was great.
Did you make lots of new friends?
Yep.
Swim in the pool?
Yep.
Davy started laughing. A teenager, he was usually the one with one-word answers. How about you? I asked him.
What?
As if he didn't know. How was your first day of being a counselor? Davy considered the question. He was munching on an apple he'd nabbed in the kitchen.
Not bad, he decided after a minute. Care to elaborate? Asked Sam.
Not really.
Okay.
Aunt Peg came by this morning, I told him. She wanted to talk about Saturday's dog show.
I know it's a major, Davy said, and that it's a big deal. I'm good to go. She doesn't need to check up on me.
That's what we told her.
For real? For real, Sam replied. You and I can practice with Tara this week if you want. But it's up to you.
Nope. Davy shook his head. I'm good.
He's good, Kevin echoed solemnly. I'm good, too.
Well, that's a pleasant state of affairs, I said. Let's hope it lasts. We made it all the way until Thursday before something went wrong.
3 days without a major problem turning up? In my house, that means we're doing great.
Davy looked upset when I picked the boys up at camp that afternoon.
What's the matter? I asked.
He glanced at Kevin and shook his head. I understood that shorthand. I'd often used it myself.
Davy and I would talk when we got home.
Sam was working in his home office, so I got Kev settled in the living room with a video game and a juice box.
Yes, I know. But sometimes when you're a mother, expediency wins out.
Besides, Kevin had just enjoyed an active day at camp, so I was pretty sure that 1 hour of lazy parenting wouldn't ruin his life.
Davy and I sat down in the kitchen. The poodles fanned out on the floor around us. Bud was on the couch with Kev. At least, I hoped he was.
There were 3 peaches in a bowl in the middle of the table. I offered one to Davy, then took one for myself. He stared at the piece of fruit in his hand as if he wasn't sure what to do with it. I hadn't yet heard a thing, and already I didn't like the way this conversation was shaping up.
Something happened today at camp, Davy said. His expression was grave.
To Kevin? I asked quickly. I started to rise. A slight shake of Davy's head made me sit back down.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.